trust everybody with the concession stand and had a chance. It's intermission. You guys not remember going to the movies when you had intermission?
Yeah.
Let's all go to the lobby. Let's all go to the lobby. And the hot dog dance and stuff. I guess I was the only sinner that went to the movies. Okay, well, Lisa's a sinner too, so she remembers too. So, and I remember going to the drive-in, going to the Skyway, playing all the playground equipment before it got dark. Okay. Man, tough room. Brother Mark, all right, just a minute, we'll do that after service, okay? I want to show you guys something that I received today. Go ahead, sister, and just slide it over there if you can, brother, whoever. It might be impossible to do it. Just have to minimize it and drag it, right? Should be able to minimize it, then drag it, then drop it in there. There we go. Okay, now enlarge it. Thank you. This is our architect's rendering of our phase one. That is cool. Okay. I don't know about you, that gets me excited.
Yeah.
Okay, because this is the back. Instead of having a picture of the front yet, this is the back. This is the multi-purpose, this is the entryway, that's the classrooms and offices and stuff right there. And so this that excites me.
Yes.
Because I know that people are getting weary of when we're going to move. You know, when we can handle what we have, then we'll move. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Father. Thank you, Jesus. I wanted to share that with you. I love the way that looks. I think that is cool. That is actually John Street. And then the other side would be Smith. Am I correct? Am I correct on that, Dean? This is the back, so it would be John and then Smith on the other side, because the front would be put in the parking lot area. It's actually, this is the back side. This is looking at the back of the church. If you look at the thing out there, this is the back looking forward. And so where the tree is will actually be the next part.
Okay, the doors,
they're facing John Street.
Oh, they're facing John Street.
Yes.
So back's actually facing Highway 9.
Back's facing Highway 9, so that way your front doors aren't facing north when you open. Okay, you with me? Okay. Well, I look stupid, but I'm not. Okay? So, I've lived in Oklahoma a long time. But I'm just telling you, this December is not typical. We were talking about that before service. And I'm telling you, this December is not typical. I wanted to share that with you. And I didn't know I was going to get that today. You know, what I'm going to preach this evening is about rebuilding the wall and Nehemiah. I think it's time for a refresher of what we do and why we're doing what we're doing. I think it's time for a refresher of what God has done for us, because it seems like we're just getting used to God just blessing us, and like it's always just been this way. Okay, thank you for the two yeps and then that's right. I appreciate that. That encourages me right along. Just understand that it hasn't always been this way. God is not always just pour blessing out on us like he is right now.
Amen.
I don't know if you know this or not, but there's a lot of people out of work.
Yeah. Yes.
Amen.
And after January, there's going to be a lot more. Unless oil prices go back up. I know I like paying $1.65 for gas, but there's a lot of people that are hurting because it's $1.65 a gallon. Amen? Okay, man. You guys, whatever. But you know, listen now. Tiger Trucks doesn't run if the oil ain't running.
That's
right. Seminole Company ain't working.
That's
right. Amen?
That's right.
Cud ain't working.
Right.
These are big time jobs.
Right.
These aren't $8.50 an hour jobs.
No.
These are big time jobs. These are jobs where men they can support families with them.
Yeah.
They can build buildings with them. They can bless churches with them.
Yeah.
But when those things are there, so we need to pray, because I'm telling you, before, after the first of the year, unless some things change, there's going to be a lot more men looking for work.
Right.
Because $34 a barrel oil is actually about $32 for the producers is what they get paid, and it costs them about $32 to produce one. So you do the math. How long can you do that and pay somebody $20 an hour? Do the math. And I must listen. I understand back in the day they're getting $4 a gallon for gas, and they should have saved so that money. I got it. And they did. A lot of them did. But some of them didn't. And some of them are having to think about this Christmas. Now, I never worked in the oil field, but there's a bunch of guys here that did. And there's a bunch of companies right now that are saying, I can't let these guys go 2 weeks before Christmas. But 2 weeks after, things could go awry. So I want you to do me a favor. I want you to start praying. See, there's some things that we got folks that come get saved, and they may even get filled with the Holy Ghost and all that stuff, but they don't get sanctified. Okay. What sanctified means? Somebody tell me.
Set apart.
They look like the world. They talk like the world. We do everything just like the world. Listen, I got ridiculed on Facebook, I guess, this week because I said something about stretch your pants. The Lord loves you. I'm going to. You're mad at me if you want. I don't know what it was because I didn't read it. My wife said, here, read this. I said, I don't read that trash. I don't read notes that are slid under my door and I don't read posts. I ain't reading it. I'm not reading it. Whatever. You know, but it's time for us to separate, because listen, there's going to come a time we're going to have to depend on God.
Amen.
Now, you guys can think that it's always going to be like today, and we can just print billions of dollars every year, and this is always, and this is never going to change, and we're always going to have plenty of money, we're always going to have, think that if you want to, we continue to print money like it's candy. Does anybody pay attention to what's going on in the world?
Yeah.
And we can keep doing that until it bursts. But I'm telling you, it's coming a time where we're going to have to depend on God.
Yeah.
When God's going to have to be our end-all and be-all, we're going to have to call things in that are not.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
Okay, I'm going to go on with this. Nehemiah chapter 3, please. I just think that's cool, and I love it. God, we call that thing done. We call it in cash in the name of Jesus. Make us a miracle and a wonder, Father, in the name of Jesus. Nehemiah chapter 3, we're going to start with verse something other. Let's start with verse 1. That'd be a great place to start. 3:1. I can't see with my glasses on and I'm closing out. I can't see with them off. I'm far away. Then Elisha, the high priest, rose up with his brethren, the priests, and they builded the sheep gate. Now, I saw the sheep gate, didn't we, Brother Tom?
Yeah.
Yes, we did. And it came to life for them. I know exactly where it's at. I can take you to Jerusalem and take you to the sheep gate. I couldn't do it 2 weeks ago, but I can do it today. To the sheep gate. They sanctified it. They set it aside for God's use. They set it aside to be used. And they set up the doors of it, even under the tower of Mia. They sanctified it. They sanctified the gate. They sanctified the doors. Come on now.
Yeah.
Jesus. And unto the tower of Haniel. Come on, the verse 2. And next unto him builded the men of Jericho. I know where Jericho is at. I can take you to Jericho. I can take you by the highway. We didn't go actually into the city, but we drove by and waved at it. Amen. And the next them building Zachur, the son of Imri. Keep going. But the fish gate did the sons of Hazaniah, is that not close enough? Build. Who also laid the beams thereof, and set up the doors thereof, and the locks thereof, and the bars thereof. Now hang on just a minute. I can read you scripture after scripture in Nehemiah chapter 3, where men are beginning to build things and do things and set things up, because the walls of Jerusalem had been torn down and they had been burned. And Nehemiah said, we're going to go build the city up. And they went back and began to build the city. Now let's go to chapter 4, if you will. Just for time's sake. Chapter 4. But it came to pass, someone said it came to pass. When Sanballat heard that we builded the wall, he was wroth and took great indignation and mocked the Jews. And he spake before his brethren and the army of Samaria and said, what do these feeble Jews? Will they fortify themselves? Will they sacrifice? Will they make an end in the day? Will they revive the stones out of the heaps of the rubbish which are burned? Now Tobiah the Ammonite was by him, and he said, even that which they build, if a fox go up, he shall even break down their stone wall. Hear, O God, hear, O our God, for we are despised, and turn their reproach upon their own head, and give them for a prey in the land of captivity. And cover not their iniquity, and let not their sin be blotted out from before thee, for they have provoked thee to anger before the builders. So built we the wall, and all the wall was joined together to the half thereof, for the people had a mind to argue. For the people had a mind to ridicule.
Work.
I think most folks have my version.
Come on.
What can we do to hinder the building of the wall? How can I hinder it instead of being mindful to work on it? I shouldn't say most people. I should say some people. So build we the wall. And the wall was joined together unto the half thereof, for the people had a mind to work. Now, I don't know when people have time to Twitter and Facebook and instant message and all that stuff, because I am busy. I don't know when people have time to know who somebody did on their birthday. Oh, by the way, birthday joke. And I don't have any idea how people have time to do this stuff, because I have a busy life. I do well to return phone calls in a timely manner. I don't know how people have time to do that stuff. And if you do that, I'm not condemning you to hell because you're on Facebook. I could care less. They could care less. I'm not condemning you for that. I'm just saying that the people had a mind to work. So I want you to get this into your spirit tonight. Are you ready to work?
Yes.
I put the picture up there because I want you to understand that doesn't happen just because we want it.
That's right.
It happens because we work for it and we strive for it and we call it. Listen, are you tired of your children not living for God? Are you tired of your children not acting crazy? Are you tired of your loved ones being lost? Then you have to work for it. You have to strive for it. You have to put some force of effort. You've got to call their name out. When's the last time you called their name before God? And said, God, save them. I don't care what it takes, save them. Now you better watch when you pray that prayer. Because hospice will be coming in. And you'll be saying your last goodbye, but their soul will be saved. Oh, God wouldn't do that. Oh, I have a brother in heaven today because of that. What? Yes. When my brother got cancer, he got real serious with God. But before that time, he didn't need God. I'll talk about my own family, and I don't care if you get mad or not. That's my brother. And I know for a fact he didn't have time for God. He didn't believe in all this. He said, I ain't got time for all that. Because I talked to him about coming to church. I tried to get him to come to church. But when he got pancreatic and stomach cancer, things changed in his life. He got real serious, real quick, with God. Are you saying God will kill me? Nope. You said, but you said, whatever it takes. So be careful when you pray that prayer. You better be specific when you pray a prayer. Because God will answer you And God will hear you. Oh, dear God in heaven, are you guys all right tonight?
Yes, the friendship.
Well, I'm going to get another Facebook post. I can feel it now. Get a shout out on Facebook. I'm glad. Praise Jesus. I'm going to be an overnight sensation. Here we go. 4:7 please. But it came to pass that when Sanballat and Tobiah and the Arabians and the Amorites and the Ashdodites, is that right? Close enough. Heard that the walls of Jerusalem were made up and that the breaches began to be stopped, then they were very wroth. Verse 8. And conspired all of them how to come in the fight against Jerusalem and to hinder it. Answer, here we go. Ready? You ready? No, you're not. Are you ready? When the walls began to be rebuilt and the breaches began to be fixed and things began to put back together. 5 years ago, God called me to this church to be the pastor of this church and to build on the foundations of this church. I'm on my fifth year. 5 years ago, first message I ever preached was out of the scriptures. Then remember, I preached to you about the prodigal son for about a month. You remember? How to look at yourself for who you really are, what you're really doing. How to come to yourself right now. Come to yourself. Look at yourself for who you truly are. Not who you think you are, not who you're going to be, but who you are right now. You remember? And I appreciate you about coming to yourself and forgetting about your past, but going for your future. Do you remember that? I spent about a month on the prodigal son. Because he was called to be great, but he was living in a pig pen. His destiny was to be the son of a rich man. Son of a man who had plenty. But his destiny was being altered by his desire. Do you remember?
Yes.
And I ask you to look at yourself. Are you going to go back to what you used to be? Or are you going to go forward with something greater? And everybody said, oh, we're going greater. Woo! Do you remember? Everybody shouted. Everybody hopped and danced and skipped. And now, I look and we're trying to revert back to hog pen. And I am about to go back then.
Amen.
You can go wallow with pigs if you want. But I'm going to where the destiny of God is taking me.
Amen.
I'm going to be a son of the Most High God.
Yes.
I am not going to settle for feeding pigs and slop. I am not going to settle for having to pour slop in a trough that I can't eat because it's not fit for human consumption. And while all around me is blessing if I'll just go home to my daddy's house. Do you remember? Then, I begged you for a while to look at the horizon. Do you remember? How big is your God? Do you remember?
Yes.
How big is your God? Remember?
Yes.
And I asked you to look at that horizon. On the other side of that horizon, there's a what?
Another horizon.
There's another horizon. When you get to that one, there's a what?
Another.
Because he's greater than your horizon. Because if you can reach him, then he ain't God. Right? Remember?
Yeah.
So I'm asking you today, when all hell is breaking loose in your life, are you still striving and reaching for greater, or are you reverting back to what you used to know because it's comfortable to stay with pigs than it is to go somewhere you don't know where you're going? So which one is it? Come on, somebody. I feel like preaching on a Wednesday.
Come on, let's hear it.
And they conspired all of them together. Who? Go back. Verse 7, please. Bless you. And it came to pass that when Sanballat and Tobiah and the Arabians and the Amorites and the Ashdodites heard that the walls of Jerusalem were made up and the breaches began to be stopped, then they were very wroth. Can I share with you that very same spirit, when you start building up what God has called you to build up, begins to attack you again? The spirit behind these men has not died, because spirits don't die. I hate to break this news to you, but you're going to live forever. Your body will die, but your spirit will live forever. It's either in heaven or in hell. It's up to you. But your spirit, you are an ever-present, everlasting being, because you're made in the image of God. Amen. And God breathed His breath into you, and He never sucked it out. And so when He breathed His breath into you, you became a what? Living soul. And when your soul is alive, it never dies.
Amen.
Your body dies. You get feeble, you get old. Your body begins to decay, but your soul never dies. It just depends on where you take it.
Amen.
So the very same spirits that have always been on the earth continue in the earth. The spirits behind Sanballat, the spirit behind Tobiah, the spirit behind the Arabians, the spirit behind the Amorites, the spirit behind the Ashdodites, they are still present on the earth. And when you are called of God to rebuild a city, when you are called to rebuild a city and all the breaches begin to be plugged up, guess who comes? The spirit of Sanballat, the spirit of Tobiah, the spirit of the Arabians, the spirit of the Amorites, the spirit of the Ashdodites, they all come and rise up to stop you from doing what God has called you to do. Can I share with you? They can rise up if they will, but God said it, in the presence of my enemies, I will build you a table, make you a table. Can I share with you? When our enemies rise up, God begins to prepare us a table.
Amen. Yep.
Amen. Come on. I'm not going anywhere. I'm going to stay on my wall.
Amen.
Come hell, come high water, I'm going to stay on my wall.
That's right.
I'm going to stay building the walls. Verse 8. Y'all quiet, like y'all don't believe it. That's okay. Y'all ain't saying nothing. That's all
right.
They conspired, all of them together, to come fight against Jerusalem and hinder it. Verse 9. Nevertheless, somebody said
nevertheless,
we made our prayer unto our God and set a watch against them day and night because of them. 20 seconds. I'm going to knock this stuff off. I'm going to kill all this stuff. Okay. Hear me. Nevertheless, we made our prayer unto our God. Church, there's going to come a time in the near future when we're going to have to learn how to pray.
Amen.
And not spend 5 minutes in prayer, but pray. Our prayer is 5 minutes of God bless me. Not all the time, just some of the time. God bless me. God take care of. God whatever. 5 minutes, maybe, a day. Some of y'all more, some of y'all less. I'm giving an average. The average preacher, as the statistics say, prays 6 minutes a day. That's what the statistics say. I didn't make the statistics. I don't know. And that's, then you can't even, that's divided by 7 days. Okay? So if the preachers aren't praying, I'm pretty confident the church is. I met a man from Tobago on our trip. Brother Cedric Forbes. I hope to God I can get him to come preach for us someday when he's in town around the United States. And I talked to him for quite a while. He's 42, he's about my age. So we talked for quite a while. I had a good conversation a couple times. And the man prays 42 years old. He has a church. Now, remember, Tobago only has 1.5 million people in the whole country. Okay? So, he's in a town of a few thousand people. He has a church that went from 45 to 300 plus in about 2 years. 2 years. Now, people say you're not supposed to count numbers, but numbers are souls. I don't care how what people say, you know, people don't have nobody in the church who will say you don't count numbers. I'm just telling you. Because people are souls. Numbers are souls. God likes numbers. That's why there's a book called Numbers. Because God likes numbers. Okay? He likes what's going on. He likes souls. But I was talking to Brother Cedric about prayer. And he said that the thing that is changing their country is the ministers are beginning to pray. Church, if we don't pray, we'll never, never achieve what it is that God has us to have. We will never get where God would have us to be. Church, if we don't pray, we'll always have problems, situations. Now, you may not believe this, and that's fine if you don't. You don't have to listen to everything I say. I can't tell everybody that listens to everything I say anyway. There's things in your life you can pray for they ever get to your door. You can pray them away before they ever get to your door.
Amen.
There's God's honest answer. There have been some girls trying to attach themselves to my son. We prayed them out. Because they ain't the one. There have been some boys trying to attach themselves to my oldest daughter. They ain't the one. I don't play when it comes to my kids. They are not the one. How do you know? Because God will tell me when the one's there. I'll know. Oh, how will you know? Because I'm listening to the Spirit of the Lord. And when a young man and a young lady walks into my house, the first thing I do is I say, listen, okay, God, you better tell me what's up. I'm a hard dad. I don't care. I got one chance to raise these children. I got one chance to pray for their souls. I get one chance in this life to make sure they make the right decisions the best of my ability. Now listen, I know they're going to make something stupid. I know they're people. They're going to do something stupid, okay? Listen. But daddy knows how to pray. And mama knows how to pray. I feel like I know the girl that my son will marry. He's 15. I ain't in no hurry for him to get married. He don't need to get married until he's 25, 30. He's good. Okay, he's good. But I think I know in my spirit who he will marry. And it ain't none of y'all kids, so don't quit looking at me, okay? So, y'all don't even know. But I think I know in my spirit who it will be. Abby, I have no clue. No clue. But Adam, I think I know. Well, yeah, that's a weird prayer. No, it's not. No, it's not. And I'm an earthly father. So how much more does your heavenly father, who Jesus said, I have prayed for you. Peter, the devil has desired to have you to sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you. And if he's prayed for Peter, he'll pray for me.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. Nevertheless, we made our prayer unto God and set a watch against them day and night because of them. Why? Why were they praying? Why were they setting a watch? Because verse 8, come back, thank you. They all conspired together to come and fight against Jerusalem and to hinder it.
Amen.
They came to hinder the work of God. And so the people of God said, we ain't going to do this. Oh my gosh. We're not going to do this. You're not going to come against the work of God. But in the church, we act like it's okay if the devil comes against us. And we play defense. What? Are you crazy? God didn't put you in a defensive stance. He put you in an offensive stance.
Amen.
He gave you things to fight.
Yes,
not just protect, but to fight.
Amen.
He He gave you a shield to go forward with.
Amen.
He gave you a sword to cut things down with.
Yes.
He gave you a helmet to duck your head behind that shield. And so nothing can hit you in the head and kill you. And nothing can get behind that shield to kill you. And you have your sword. Nothing can hit you in front of your leg. The only thing that can get you is in the back. When you turn around and run. That's the only time the enemy can get hold of you is when you turn around and run. Because church cannot play bad with you and plead with you for just a minute. Would you please get angry enough? Would you please get tired enough of the devil messing with the things of God that you turn and say, I'm going to pray to God and I'm going to set up a watch day and night because of the things that are attacking my church?
Amen. That's right.
Would you please get angry enough and not just at me? But such as at the enemy that would attack you, would you please get angry enough at the spirits that would come against the church that you would just say, you know what, I've had enough. I'm going to pray to my God and I'm going to set up a watch day and night.
Come on.
Verse 10. Ooh, I got 15 minutes, Lord. I'm going to do this now. And Judah said, who?
Judah.
What's it due to me?
Praise.
You know, y'all think I just get up here because I want y'all to clap. There is power in praise.
Amen.
You ever watch those movies? Oh, we got it all saved. I forgot. Lisa, you ever watch those movies? Y'all all saved and watch the movie. When I get the priest out there to get rid of the devil, and all the priests always get killed. They got holy water, they got crosses, the devil it kills them. You know why? No praise going on. Judah, praise, said, the strength of the bearers and burdens is decayed, but there is much rubbish. Hang on now. Hang on. I ain't got time for this. Okay. So that we are not able to build the wall. Praise said, when I'm up there praising, I'm trying to get some rubbish out the way. When you're out here worshiping, I'm trying to get some rubbish out of the way. Because when I get here, I'll tell you, I'll just be honest with you, I told you earlier, when I got here, I was down a little bit. Down. But when I get on that keyboard and we begin to sing songs, it was the same way when he used to play drums. They used to get behind those drums and start playing songs and begin to worship. Yeah. It's the same way when I didn't do any of that stuff and just sit out here in the audience and just worshiped. Because you don't have to play something to worship. You know, I got 10 strings. I got a bass drum. I got it. You hear me? And I don't need nobody. See, I want to know, can you praise when there ain't no music going on? I want to know when there's not anybody prodding you, can you praise? Because praise gets the rubbish out of your life and gets you to understand, that it's time to build walls. It's time to get the walls built back up Jerusalem again. It's time to do the work that God's called us to do. It's time for us, this church, my God, I'm tired of preaching it. It's time for us to step up. We've got to be the men and women of God that God's called us to be. I preached this Sunday morning. Put your big boy pants on, God said. I got a couple of questions I want to answer. I want to answer from you. If you'll read that, you'll study that. It means get ready for battle. Gird yourself up like a man is what it says. Get ready for battle, God said, because we're going to battle right here, baby. I got some questions I want answers to. Remember? So Judah, praise said, strength of the bearers of burdens is decayed. Are you getting tired? Are you getting weary? Are you getting weak by carrying the stuff that you're not supposed to? Listen, we're carrying rubbish and we're supposed to be praising. Amen? Yeah. Judah said, the strength of the bearers of burdens is decayed, and there is much rubbish so that we are not able to build the wall. The devil is the liar.
Amen.
Verse 11, I'll let you go. Verse 11. And our adversary said, they shall not know, neither see, till we come in the midst among them and slay them and cause the work to cease. Can I share with you, the temple of praise, look at me right now. Look at my notes. You are not this naive, I know, to think that because you come to church, because you may give your tithe, because you may give out offerings, because you may give special offerings, because you come and you read your word, because you have studied the word of God, I know you're not so naive to think that the devil is not trying to slip into your life and try to slay you, that the work of God can be ceased. Listen, I don't preach we're a city on a hill that cannot be hidden because it gets a good amen. I really believe that. That is in my spirit, that God has placed us here to be a signal to the world and to be a signal to the lost, to the dying and the dead. I really believe it. I don't preach it because I want you to clap for me or just say amen for me. But the devil has decided to try to cut the snuff out that life and try to take our savor away. Because salt with no savor is not worth anything.
Amen.
And I've got to get across to you today. It's time for us to quit talking about it and start doing it.
Amen.
And start doing it. My leadership, hear me. Leadership, look at my face. And those that aren't here, tell them that I said this. We have got to be there for each other and quit tearing each other down, trying to promote ourselves to some other way. I've chosen you to be leaders because I thought you could lead. Now prove to me that you can. I prayed and I sought God, and you're the name that God gave me. So now prove to me that you can lead. Because if you can't, then I can't work with you. I refuse to go back to the hog pen and the slop. I'm going forward with God. I'm going forward with God. If I have to go help somebody else do what God's called me to do, then bless God, that's what I'll do. But I will not go back to the hog pen. I will not. I refuse. I have been there, Brother Dean, and I'm not going back. I am not going back, Joey. I've been in this church for 40 plus years, and I ain't going back how it used to be, neither.
Amen.
And I don't care who that makes mad.
Amen.
I ain't going back to it. I refuse. Yes, we had some great things, and yes, we did some awesome things, and God moved in our lives, and we did some really wonderful things. And God was great to us, and I don't ever, listen, you've heard me preach before. You know I love my raising, and I love the fact, I preach this Sunday morning. The foundations that we have are deep, and they're great. And listen, remember the five things I gave you for, okay? Remember, God's God, your name, remember? Okay? I love the very foundations of those. But those spirits that I ask you to cast out of here, raise their head. And you can make me, listen, I'm very easy to get along with. I'm probably too easy to get along with. But you jack with my church and you make me mad. Quickly. You mess with my church and you make me mad quickly. I got to calm down for a couple days before I deal with stuff. They're going to be like, really? For real? When my pastor was here, and I used to hear people dog him, they used to tick me off so bad, I'd have to calm down for a couple days before I had to say something to somebody about it. Because he was my pastor. Still is my pastor. Most people don't care. They just run, eh. But I cared. I still care. Because he's my pastor and my soul is depending upon what he preaches and breathes into my life. And I want a fresh word from God. I need a challenging word from God. But I need leadership that I can count on. That when the going gets tough, they stand strong. And they don't crumble. and they don't devour each other.
Amen.
Well, that's good preaching, Brother Jeff. I appreciate
you. That's real good preaching.
And they don't devour each other. But they stand as a team against the wall and say, come on, get us, big boy. I've got a sword in one hand, I got a trowel in the other. Come on, get you some. Come get you some. I can prove it. I can read it. I got 6 minutes. Let's read.
Come on now.
Let's go to verse 12. I think it's 12. That may be further than that. No, it's further than that. I got to look and see where it's at. I don't want to waste your time.
Oh, come on now.
Amen. Verse 4. Chapter 4, sorry. Verse 17. Let's try 17. And they which build it on the wall, and they that bear burdens with those that laid it, every one with hand on his hands brought with his work, and with the other hand held onto a weapon. I wish somebody just tell the devil, come get you some. Come get you some. I guess he's tired of weak-kneed, jelly-backed Christians that act like the devil got more power than you got. But I just failed. No, you wanted to fall. Not all the time. But sometimes we use that excuse so we can go sin. Because sex is our God instead of God being our God.
Come on.
And we just want to go have sex with somebody, so we'll say, oh, I failed. Yeah, whatever. Whatever. You wanted to. You looked to fall. Ooh, got quiet up in here, boy. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name. You wanted to get drunk. You wanted to get high. Don't blame the devil. Judge who you are to your own self right now. Who am I? I wanted to get drunk. I wanted to get high. And so I did. I have no notes, so y'all just, you know, y'all on your own. But I'm looking for somebody. I'm looking for somebody that knows who they are, stands on a wall, and says, devil, come get you some. If you want some of me, come get some. Because I've got the word of God, which is a sword, and I will cut your little goofy head off. I got a shield to quench the fiery darts. I got a helmet of salvation that you can't hit me in the head. I got a breastplate of righteousness. My feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Listen, there's nothing you can do here. I'm standing on a wall, and I'm traveling with this hand looking for the devil with this one. I'm trying to hurry, but y'all said it's okay. So go. Yeah. For the builders, every one had his sword girded by his side, and so builded. And he that sounded the trumpet was by me. Come on now. Verse 19. Verse 20. In that place, therefore, ye hear the sound of the trumpet. Restore ye thither unto us, our God. Why do we back up when the devil attacks? Listen, when the devil attacks, it is not the time to go crying to your mama.
Amen.
It is the time to run towards your enemy. It's time to go run toward that Goliath. The Bible doesn't say that David hid behind a rock and threw it with his sling. He said he ran toward Goliath. He ran toward him as hard as he could go. Come get you some, big boy. And the rock didn't kill Goliath. David, after he knocked him down, boom, ran and got his own sword from Goliath and cut the fool's head off. I'm telling you right now, it is time we cut the devil's head off.
There you go.
Yeah.
And quit hiding behind rocks and sticks and shrubbery.
There you go.
And trying to hope maybe we might hit him with a rock. Run toward our enemy. Run toward our adversary with sword blazing.
That's right.
Come get you some. And just... Listen, you're going to get attacked anyway, so you might as well get the first punch in. You might as well get the first hit. You're going to get hit, you might as well hit back. Because no weapon formed against me shall. That doesn't mean no weapon shall be formed, right? Just means it shall not. Because I'm going to be what God's called me to be. Hear me, church. I'm going to wrap it up in a nice little pretty book. Ready? Here you go. God has called us. He has called me. I'll just put it in the singular vernacular. God has called me to rebuild the walls of this facility. Spiritually. He has called me from our very foundations to raise up men and women who are true men and women of God. And not just churchgoers, but men and women of God. He has called me to ask you to do one thing, and that is simply trust and obey Him. That is all I ask you to do. I don't ask you to do anything but other than what God has said to do, which is trust and obey and follow. What is he? Listen, see the horizon? There's another one. Do what God's called us to do. Don't get off the wall because the spirits of Sanballat and Tobiah and the Amorites and the Arabians and the whatever those bikes were. Spiritites, whatever they were, I don't know. Edits. Just because that spirit rises up against us, please don't come off the wall. I need you. I need you to be on the wall. I need you, number one, to be praying and seeking His face. Number two, I need you to be doing your job on the wall. Sword in one hand, trowel in the other. Getting it done. Amen? Y'all get anything out of that? I hope so, because I'm tired. Stand up.